This world is not the Christian's heaven. It is merely the fitting up place. It is the scene of our life battles, our conflicts, and sorrows. God takes none to heaven but those who are first made saints in this world through the grace of Christ. Only the pure, the good, and the holy will dwell with Christ when he cometh into his kingdom. Welcome to the Steps to Life Camp Meeting 2011.
My journey started years ago. I grew up in a city in California. I was very unhappy with city life. I didn't enjoy it. My grandparents lived in the country. And every summer, as a youngster, I would go out to Grandma and Grandpa's and spend part of the summer out there, and Grandma always grew a garden. A lot of the older folks knew how to do that, and that art has almost been gone. The art, and I use the word art, of growing food has been a long education for me. That's where I first got my teeth cut on seeing food grown. I grew up in a city, like I said. I didn't know really much about food growing preparations at all. I could remember as a youngster, my mom going out to a farm, a Korean man that we went year after year, that raised food on this little small farm. I think he had about 5 or 8 acres. And I can barely remember some of the things that he did. And I grew up until I eventually got wild hairs and ended up in the back to land or hippie movement. And it was actually through those years that I was on a research in my own heart and own life trying to find something, you know, fulfilling in life. And so it took me down a long different path. I ended up in Central America homesteading. And while I was in Central America homesteading, my experience with growing food really started out there. And it was very kind of orthodox, but yet unorthodox. And from that point of the way I saw my grandmother raising food, the way we attempted to try to grow food and stuff like that was the beginning points of my life experience and thinking that that's the way you did gardening. And the way I early learned was that you had to have quite a bit of land to get enough production to be able to live on, when in fact, some of the things I'll be trying to plow through with you folks in the next few hours is that you can actually, on 1 acre of land, feed 100 people. And it's quite amazing. It has been shown over and over again the ability that it can be done and is being done. My life journey has taught me through a lot of different experiences. Once I came back from Central America, I had a traumatic experience down there. I about lost both of my legs. I was one of those hippies that Calvin probably met along his journeys down in South America and Central America. And I was homesteading down there. And while I was there, I about lost both of my legs with a flea epidemic that was carrying a bacterial disease. And it was while I was back in the mountains, couldn't get out, my legs were swollen, couldn't walk anymore. I was bedridden basically in my little mud hut that we had built, and I'd given up all hope of living. I thought for sure I was just going to, you know, die down there. And like I said, we were living back in the mountains. We lived on what we grew. So it was very hard to be... for me to be laying up in my hut sick and really actually losing my legs. Didn't know anything about natural remedies. Didn't know much of anything, but we wanted to live that hippie life, you know, back out in the mountains and away from society and all those type of things. Well, Enoch, a good friend of mine, had read a little pamphlet, and at this time, I was searching. I'd left the drug world. I'd left all the... you know, as you have these pictures in your mind of the hippie world, I left all that behind. I was looking for something better. I just lost my best friend to a drug overdose. It really threw me for a back end spin. And I just wanted to get away, and I wanted to find something that had to be something more fulfilling. Went down there to spend some time in Honduras. And while there, I ended up through this experiencing this experience, and it just drove me really to my knees. And while I was there, someone turned me on to the book Desire of Ages and Ministry of Healing. And I had a lot of time, so I started praying and really searching. You know, Christ was this thing out there, and it was religion for people in shirts and ties. And I definitely wasn't into shirts and ties. I'm not against shirts and ties, so you can forgive me. But, you know, in my mindset in those years. And while I was having this experience, Enoch had read this little pamphlet compiled by somebody on the use of charcoal therapy by Ellen White. I didn't know anything about it. Well, he applied charcoal to my legs, and lo and behold, it wasn't a matter of just a few days, and my legs were totally turned around. That turned me towards alternative thinking. You know, I was already heading in that direction, but it really turned me. There has to be more to this story. Because we'd already started turning towards alternative gardening. We were trying to get away from chemicals. We were trying to get away from all those things. We wanted to understand how to do a sustainable gardening. So all this kind of fit together, and the Lord was directing my life at that time, and I really didn't realize that. I met Jesus in a real way through the book Desire of Ages and fell in love with him. He became my lover. He became my best friend. And from there, my life journey began. And it has been a long haul. That was like 35, 36 years ago. And so what I'm going to try to condense down for you folks in this issue of growing food in hard times is basically the discussion I'm supposed to be having with you is growing food in hard times. How many of us here believe that we are living in hard times? I hope you honestly believe and mean that, and you're not just raising your hand just because peer pressure. Because I'm going to tell you something, folks. I was flying up here yesterday, and I was sitting in the airport waiting to be picked up, and I have been going back through this little book called The Ceiling by Elder Loughborough. Y'all seen this little pamphlet? It's called Questions on the Ceiling Message by J.N. Loughborough, which is one of our early pioneers. He was actually the historian for Adventism. All right? Now, you can go down the hall down there, and you'll see his picture on the wall. Now, in this little booklet, Elder Loughborough quoted some things from Sister White showing that in 1848, when the ceiling work began, now, this is really where I'd like to be lecturing, but I'm not supposed to go there. When the ceiling message began, there became all this terrible turmoil in Europe, and it just upheaved quickly, beginning to fulfill Revelation chapter 7. Sister White called that the beginning of the time of trouble. All right? How many years ago has that been? A long time. Way before any of us have been around. So this process of the time of trouble is a process where she states in a number of places that it will accelerate and get greater and greater and greater as we get towards the end. You believe that? Well, I'm going to tell you something, folks. We are there. We are in a time of trouble. I can remember as a hippie sitting in a restaurant in California, a hippie restaurant, with these long-haired freaks talking about, there's going to come a time, man, when you can't grow food because it's going to get so hard. We better get out on the land and grow our food or we're going to get hungry. Well, this is a bunch of freaks, man. A bunch of hippies talking this. You couldn't get a Christian one to talk this kind of talk back in the 70s. I grew up as a Seventh-day Adventist. Went all the way through my academy years in an Adventist academy. Didn't know none of this. Was never told none of this stuff. And it didn't take until years later that by Jesus' grace that it began to turn my life back to loving the man. And I'm going to tell you something, folks. We are living in a time. I was on the plane yesterday coming in, sitting next to a man that lives here in the Wichita area. And we got to talking a bit, and he says, you know, we're in trouble. I sat there and went like, wow, man, here's the rocks crying out. We're in trouble. I said, what's going on? He said, man, we've lost over half of our wheat crop here in Kansas. Our wheat production in Kansas, in many parts of Kansas, is less than half. That's not just here in Kansas, folks. Do you understand the seriousness of that? We're not just talking about wheat. You've lost your corn crop nearly. And it's not happening just in the USA because we're no longer the USA. We're now a global community, as you know, right? This situation of the time of trouble is fast crossing the lands all across the world. While we Seventh-day Adventists sit here in our idleness, depending on Walmart, Kroger's, Safeway's, in all these major food stores, when they shut down, what's going to happen to you? Your bellies are going to itch, I'll tell you right here and now. If you don't know how to grow food and grow it seriously and take it seriously, it's going to be rough. It's going to be real rough. You know, I've wondered for years, as I began to start reading and become more serious about my life journey, in the journey with Christ, how exactly is this thing going to happen? How in the world is it going to get to the point where globally you cannot buy and sell? Do you know where we're at, folks? Do you know what's going on right now while we're talking? This nation has been sold out to a global system that has global control over everything in your life. And they're trying desperately to stop organic farmers like myself from having independence. Now, what I want to try to stress to you is the importance of you taking this subject serious. Missionary work, it goes together, folks. This process, I'm going to tell you something. This whole process of what God has done, my wife and I have gone through a number of journeys of we look at the Seventh-day Adventist picture. My wife and I both came kind of melt down through this hippie background kind of stuff. Tired of the whole system. We're looking for something better. Well, we get to reading these books and we keep reading this stuff about self-supporting ministry. And I'm going like, where? Where are they self-supporting themselves? Our academies have lost the self-supporting spirit, have they not? Then we turn away from the Adventist Academy systems and we start looking to the self-supporting academy systems. Are they self-supporting? Or are they supported by true self-supporting? Very little. Agriculture has disappeared, which was to be the key of the educational system. The ABCs of education, this little book called Country Living, you all have seen it? Read it, digest it, think about it, and put it into practice. I mean, I cut my teeth on this little booklet. I don't even know where I got it from. And I started reading it, and I went like, oh, wow. Out of the cities. Over 100 years ago, the scream went forth out of the prophet's mouth, get out of the cities, acquire a country piece of land, and learn how to support yourself on that land. Well, I'm going to tell you something, folks. I've heard a number of Adventist preachers go around preaching about get out of the cities in the last few years. But I've heard very little of these men teach you how to support yourself out there on that land. It's become a hobby, hasn't it, with a lot of us? We grow a little garden, we grow a little food, and we're content with that until the whammer hammer hits. And that's been my concern. My concern is in hopes that you can understand that you can support yourself. You can financially sustain yourself in the times that we live in. That's hard times. People are losing their jobs in the Babylonian system. Thank God. People are losing where they don't know how to support themselves, or they don't have a high education, that they're not fitting into that system. Well, I'm going to tell you something. I don't have a super high education either. But I can tell you, if you depend on Christ, He will lead you step by step. Wherever He leads you, follow Him. Revelation chapter 14, verse 1, they do what? They follow the Lamb wheresoever He leads them. Now, in that process of time, I began to take it serious and realizing that, you know, I never thought I'd ever be up here talking to people about gardening. I mean, honestly, I mean, I've lectured a lot on alternative medicine. I've lectured on Bible prophecy. I've lectured on all kinds of areas, but I never really thought I'd ever be up here teaching people how to garden. I really didn't, because it was kind of a thing that my wife and I did when we first married, and that's coming on 32 years ago. And we have gardened over the years, and it's turned from a garden into bigger gardens. And it went from a bigger garden into a bigger garden. It just kept swelling up. And then I began to realize as time went on that the demand in the society that we live in has become very intense on wanting alternative food. That is natural food without poisons and without chemicals. They want medicines that are healing, not killing. They want lifestyles that are fulfilling. And it just kind of polarized me into this field. And I hope it doesn't get too wild, because I cannot afford to be up here too long. Right now, as I speak, my wife's at a farmer's market with my son. And I'm just going to give you an overview, and then we're going to get on with this thing. We are right now on a small little farm. We own 14 acres. I sold my 70-acre farm, scaled down to really do what I really wanted to do, and that was get everything tight. And where I was going with you is, through my journey of gardening, we have tested and tried a number of different methods. And I feel where we're at now is in our final phase of our learning process of how to make this thing really, really work for anybody that's willing to work. It takes a lot of work. I put in 12 to 14 hours a day. But at the process of the returns, we eat and live like kings and queens. I can say and boast of that before the Lord, that the prophet told us that we would live like kings and queens if we would obey him and do as he's asked us to do. And I can testify before my brethren, my wife and children have had hard times. It's been a tough journey. It's tough in the body. It's tough in the mind. It's worked out character points in your life when you have to face hard times and you get aggravated and the sweat's running in your eyes and the bugs are buzzing around your head and biting you in the neck. And you find out whether you really are depending on Jesus or not. Because it is not exactly the most fun thing to live in the South, where the humidity is super high and the bugs are plentiful. In Tennessee, I think they raised the bugs for the United States. And it is a challenge to deal with these umpteen billion bugs that are constantly either trying to eat your plants or eat you. And so where we are now in our journey has come to a point where it has really fixed some things in our hearts and minds to see how intently it can work. We are financially not wealthy. We are not making the biggest bucks in the world. It's not all. You got to have some money just to survive on this old planet, unfortunately. The Lord has opened the markets up for us, not just to sell good, wholesome food, but it's opened the markets up for sick people. Because on our banner is a certified naturally grown farm. We put natural healing and natural farming. So it gave people the idea that we were into both aspects of this lifestyle. And it's actually opened doors up that it wouldn't have opened up otherwise. From people at the markets or people coming to us. But financially, the markets and selling produce or the people coming to the farm or us delivering to local markets has actually worked, which is not high dollars, but it's worked up to $1,200 right now a week in sales. Now, I'm going to tell you something, folks. That's good money. That's good money. Do you understand what I'm saying? We're only farming 2.5 acres. Do you understand how much money that is coming as a profit off of 2.5 acres? A week? That's pretty good. And I'm going to tell you something. By the Lord's grace, we hope to double that, hopefully by next year. In the journey that we've been on, we have found, I think, and it all, I give the Lord Jesus the glory, but I'm going to tell you something. Those old hippies have done things that the good Christian Adventist people have not done. And I'm going to tell you something. It was through an old hippie that went through the 60s movement that has mastered these techniques. And I sat at his feet in his books. And I said, you know, this has got to work. I'm going to put it to it. And sure enough, we are running on this farm, and you'll see some of the pictures. What you see here is this actually is just a piece of this whole thing. This whole thing is planted in 2.5 acres you can't see. And we're going to go down through some pictures, not right now, but our next series, we're going to start, our next meeting, we'll go through some of this. But you see a number of different plantings here of food and how it's going to work. And that's what I want to kind of explain to you folks so you can see. But before we get to that, so I don't overstress myself and you on the issue of living in hard times, which I definitely believe we're there, that we're living in hard times. And it's high time that we take this thing serious about getting serious about growing food. And I'm going to tell you something, folks. You're not going to be, if you're a Christian and you're a true Seventh-day Adventist Christian, you're not going to live for yourself. You're going to live because there's going to be people that are going to get mighty hungry in the near future. And you're going to grow and you're going to serve your community all around you. And I believe at a short time before us, we're going to have doors open up before us if we're going to be available by the Lord to be used. And we've yet, you know, and I believe this is part of the work that will open up doors to the community. When they're hungry, you will have enough food to feed, at least if you're farming correctly, intently, the land that you have on 1 acre, you can feed 100 people. Do you know how serious that is? There was this guy that I learned under in some of his books that he worked for a college that was an alternative hippie new age type of college that actually fed 125 people on 1.5 acres from the farming that he did for the farm. He put it before the community and the world that he lectured before. What's happened to the colleges, the private colleges, the secular colleges? Where did the farm go? And he created and developed a program that actually sustained the school as a self-supporting institution as a bunch of hippies and New Agers. Does that hit you upside the head at all? And I don't mean to be rebuking anybody in here, but you just have to forgive me. But somehow we've lost it. Somehow we've lost the vision or something. We have been reprogrammed and re-educated in the mind of this world to where we don't think self-supporting anymore. We think self-supporting means we have to go out across the country and beg people for money to support our work. I'm going to tell you something, folks. Thank God for the people that support ministries. But we shouldn't depend on that. We should be dependent on the manpower and the God-given abilities we have to support the work that God has given us to do, whether it's a big ministry or whether it's a small one. And I believe farming is one of those industries. I do believe that. I've seen it work. I know it's working. Now, without enough spanking, it's become so part of me that I can't help it. I want to encourage you all. I really do. I don't want to just whip you. I want to give you some hope. It is able, no matter how, I'm 56 years old. Don't tell me you can't do it. When I have young men that are in their 20s coming out there hanging their tongues out and can't figure out how in the world I do it, it's because of God's beautiful way. He's promised to sustain you and support you if you'll obey Him. And I believe that because believe me, folks, there's times when I'm out there with blisters on my hands because I got 5 billion weeds to deal with. And I don't like to have any, as you can see. Now, if you look at the rows there, right there, and all this there, you can walk anywhere in that 2.5 acres and you won't find a weed, maybe once or twice. Now, I'm going to tell you good. I'm going to tell you something. That doesn't happen by herbicides. I will not use an herbicide. It's deadly, toxic poison. It will kill you. But you eat them every day when you go down to Walmart or Kroger's. And let me tell you something. You're sustaining yourself with chemicals that are more deadly than some of the drugs out of the drug stores. And they know it. Now, I don't want that stuff in my belly. I don't know about you. I would rather have some food that I can trust and people. People are becoming more. I was surprised back when I get off track. Back when we started this stuff, when the hair was here and, you know, and everything else was wherever or nowhere, you couldn't give organic food away. Nobody, like, organic? What the world's that? You know, they thought you put your horse dung or human dung out there and grew it in. You know, I mean, there were some crazy ideas. And so. No, you couldn't hardly give it away. Now, you can't grow enough. We go to market every 4 days out of the week. And I'm going to tell you something. It's a mind blower. It is absolutely surprising the amount of people that are drawn to sustainable agriculture now. We're not talking about the New Age hippie freaks that come around looking like New Age hippie freaks today. You know, which I love and appreciate because that's where my heart and head's been for a long time, I guess, in Adventism, is I like some of their free ideas. And I'll leave it right there. And yet it's come from that to where we now have 75 and 85-year-old people that come to the market looking for chemical-free food. That is a new turn in society. That hasn't always been. And when I saw that beginning to happen, it thrilled me through and through because it gave me an avenue where I knew we could make a living with this. I knew when the public were now aware of the goodness of good alternative food without poisons, that we could financially support ourselves in whatever kind of work we wanted to do. And that's where it's turned towards. And that brings me back to the beginning. How do you do this? You know, it's been a journey, and it's been an education for me. And like I said, I feel like we've got to a point in our journey to where I really think it's the ultimate best way of agricultural farming. I really do. And I can't take any credit for it. I've just set it various ones' feet and learned and asked the Lord's for blessings and guidance. And believe me, I believe it many times, and through my frustrations, He stood there right beside me, guiding my hands. It's thrilling when people can come out there to the farm and it blows their mind because they see something that's like a Garden of Eden. That thrills my heart. I love to see people thrilled about something that's being done without poisons, without chemicals, and walk out there and say, "This is really beautiful." That's fulfilling to me. I know I shouldn't get any praise out of it, and I don't mean that way, but the Lord is good, and it's just amazing. So again, how does it work? How do you really make this thing take off? Well, the first thing you got to start with is, what are you? What are you? What is man, as the Bible talks about? He is nothing more than the dust of the ground. Now, let's get some glory out of that. I don't care what color we are, what age we are, we're all of the same mud. And when you melt down that mud and you tear that mud apart, that mud is made up of all kinds of materials. And I'm not going to take a lot of time to break down the soil for you, the mud that you're made of, but I want to just share just a few ideas with you to get to some very key points of understanding so that you will understand why we go the way we go and why we're doing what we're doing. You look at psoriasis, for instance. Anyone in here knows what psoriasis is? Okay. With an alternative background and an education alternative medicine, psoriasis has been treated by many different physicians over the years, by all kinds of drugs, all kinds of herbs, and all kinds of cleansings, and all kinds of different techniques, but its ultimate bottom end of psoriasis is a mineral deficiency. We have a lot of mineral deficient diseases today. You know that? I could list them on the board up here and go right down. Cancer. Cancer is caused because of an extreme mineral deficiency in the system. It breaks down your immune system. We could go through a whole lot of different areas, and I'm not here to talk on alternative medicine to you. But I want you to see the importance of what I'm saying. Those minerals, there's major minerals and minor minerals. There are air elements, and there's various other types of elements that are come forth from this combination of the soil, okay? When the Lord made the garden, Genesis chapter 1, in creation, it was done with wisdom. I was an old hippie coming off of LSD and smoking pot that could probably fill half this building up. And I was in Central America trying to get my head cleared up. And I went for 5 years struggling over LSD trips that would hit me after never touching this stuff after 5 years. I was in Central America, grew up as a Seventh-day Adventist, knew nothing about this book, just knew about it, and that's about it. And for the first time in my life, I started to say, well, you know what? I said, I guess I better try to figure out what's in this book and read it. It's supposed to be, you know, the Christian's book, the Word of God. And I started reading Genesis. I said, oh, yes, there's the hippie's heaven. I said, that is it, man. That's the garden. And that's the way I thought. You just have to forgive me. And I was so thrilled. I said, wow, He set up the program we've all been searching for. And here it is. And so I started reading down through the Bible, and I began to realize that God's plan for man was actually right there in the book of Genesis, the first two or three chapters. I began to realize that it was there, and as I began to research, I found that man was the soil, and everything else that was in the garden was a product of that soil. The animals ate the grass, they ate the leaves, They were not carnivorous. They were fruititarians, which I was a fruititarian in my hippie years. And that's why I went like, wow, this is ultimate. And man was not eating animals. Man wasn't milking cows to suck from the udder. All this was all there in the garden. I thought this was so neat. And then as time passed, I began to realize that there was a similarity between man and the earth. And as the years passed and I started studying alternative things, I began to realize that the further we get away from the earth and its balance that God originally gave us, the sicker we became. Nations of people have disappeared from this earth because of their abuse of nature. They worshiped it, but never really took care of it. Do you understand what I'm saying? If you don't take care exactly what the Lord says you have dominion over, as you read there in the Genesis account, He gave them dominion, and that word dominion was not to dominate over as a denomination. As a control freak, if you please. But they were to garden, they were to protect, they were to keep, they were to care for. What would happen if they quit caring for it? If they quit caring for it, it would quit caring for them. Do you understand the impact of that? Huh? This is a class, this isn't me lecturing now. I'm lecturing, but I want you all to be input on it. If we do not take care of the earth, it will quit take caring of us. Now, I'm going to tell you something. I mentioned this the last time I was up here. We've got land right now. I'm not going to say that. We've got land right now that is sterile in the United States. You know why? Because these wise men of the earth came along after a world war and had all these chemicals to deal with, and they started using chemicals instead of alternative methods of farming. And they started encouraging the farmers to start using these chemicals to raise their production up. And it's a long, hard story. But you give it a few years of them doing that. It looked great at the beginning. But if you take those chemicals away from the farmer right now, and you cannot get them, you know what's going to happen to your farm? Go try and raise some corn on soil that's been heavily pushed with nitrates. And yet on a sustainable program, you can get your soil to a point where you have 3 to 4 years of not having to do one thing to it to grow food. Let's look at the soil. When you take this vast country right here where you live, and you take a soil that's been raped for years without rebalancing it properly, they come out here and they throw hydrogen nitrate or whatever nitrate they put on here the last time I was up here to stimulate the ground to get hay without replacing the trace minerals and the elements that it properly needs to make good grass. They can stimulate grass, but is it grass? Huh? You can stimulate the soil to produce a carrot. Is it a carrot? That's the point we're talking about here. We want a carrot. When people bite into a carrot off of my farm, they go like, wahoo. This is a carrot. We just sold our last 200 feet, which had 3 rows in a 200-foot bed, as I was showing you up there on the board. We sold our last 200 feet of carrots to the carrot. If they tasted rotten, let me tell you something, folks. Have you ever bit into a carrot that was just kind of like, just was not tasty? You can't raise carrots in the heat, we're told, and get a sweet carrot. Huh? You ever, no one knows about carrots in here. Anybody grow carrots in here? Can you get a good sweet carrot in the heat by the Orthodox mindset? No. But let me tell you something. It's almost the 4th of July down at home, just like it is up here. It's almost July. We've had 95 and 98 degree weather down in Tennessee a month ahead of schedule. That bed of carrots, which we're harvesting 8 to 10 inch carrots, they don't raise carrots in Tennessee like this, they say. You can't raise carrots on the plateau. Oh, yeah?
I've been digging and eating my own potatoes for a month.
Hello? We just about finished 10 rows at 200 feet of potatoes. Sold almost every last one of them up to today. There's more of them in the market today. People, they get a hold of these potatoes and they go like, wow, what are you doing to these things? They bite a hold of a potato that's that big around and it tastes like one of these new baby potatoes. The people are just going like, you know, and they flock to our table because of it. They're eating food that has something in it that they can taste. And that's what I want to discuss with you right from the front end, is the importance of that soil. If your soil is not alive, you are not alive. You can garden all you want. You can think that you're even doing it naturally. But I'm going to tell you something. I hope you know more than I do. But it's been a long journey for me to get this thing squared off in my head and understand how to make a carrot become a carrot. How to make a beet. Most people eat a beet and they go like, yuck. They're too woody. There's not much. They're just kind of like a taste. You know what I mean? I'm going to tell you something. We sell every beet we put on the table. Maybe sometimes not all of them, but most all of them. And we raise celery. They don't raise celery in Tennessee. I grew up in California, the Valley, man, and they raised celery as this tall. I'm going to tell you something, folks. We just finished 200 heads of celery that were this tall. Yeah. Fat, nice stalks coming up out of there. Huge, great, big. Took them to the market. People were like, boom. We couldn't keep enough. I've got another 150 in the garden right now about this tall. Yeah. Amazing. And I'm going to tell you something, folks. It's in the soil. It's in the soil. If the soil is alive, remember, that soil is a living community. This ministry could not exist without cooperation as a group of people, could it? If there was disorganization in this ministry, this ministry would be dead tomorrow, right? It's got to be properly organized. And when you look at the soil, you look at the soil as a community. It's a living, thriving community. And if you put stuff in that soil that kills that community, you just killed your garden. You killed your food production. That's if you're trying to use natural methods. But if you use some of these highly toxic chemicals, you can make it look like whatever you want to make it look like. You can make corn look like corn all you want, but it is not corn. I remember when I was in Central America, and I grew up in a city in California, and I didn't know hardly but what my grandma grew out in her little garden. And I went to Central America, and I was out in the middle of the mountains homesteading. And this native guy would trade us corn that he raised for honey or whatever he needed. We'd bartered and traded, and that was one of the ways we got along down there. And he brought corn, and I never tasted corn in my life like this corn. It was just, I said, man, what do you do? And this guy used techniques that he learned for who knows how many years. It had been around in those mountains. And it was just really good. And comes to find out, it was simply based on that he used simple methods of rotate cropping. He didn't always plant in the same ground. Now, soil. Let's get back to the soil issue. When you've got soil, and I don't care what type of soil you have, the one chief component that you've got to have in that soil is organic matter. And you've got to have lots of organic matter. And if you're lacking organic matter, your soil is going to lack, because you've got to have those living organisms in that soil that thrive and feed upon organic matter. Now, I probably go from probably around 30 tons a year that I put into my 2.5 acres. You understand how much that is? That's a big pile. Now, just to get right to the nitty-gritty of the dirty end of this job, everybody can look at that picture up there. They can all go up there and look at that and say, oh, glory. You know, oh, that's just so nice. Oh, wouldn't I love to have that? And oh, wouldn't that be just so beautiful to be in? But they never think of the dirty end of the job. All right? Now, I'm going to take you to the dirty end of the job. And it's either going to make your gut say forget it, or you're just going to end up realizing that's just part of it. And I order a base of some kind of manure, whether it's cow, horse, or chicken. Now, we can have a great big controversy in here about that, so I'm not going to go there right now with you. I'm just going to tell you the facts. You got to have some kind of base that has a nitrogen base, whether it's organic or inorganic. You've got to have something as a base. And with that base, I bring in a number of truckloads, big truckloads, and dump it in a windrow. All right? It's called composting. You ever heard that word? A lot of people have these little bitty composters, or these little turners about that big around, and get a little compost and they think they got garden. Well, let me tell you something, folks. Forget it. You want some soil that's rich? You got to have compost. I got a row right now that's 50 foot long, 4.5 feet tall, and about 8 feet wide. Windrow of compost right now. Now, we just went through our spring season of broccoli, cauliflower, cabbages, and various other different products that are basically done. You harvest the cabbage, you harvest the cauliflower, you harvest your broccoli, and here you got the byproduct that is your leaf and your stalk and all that junk. And let me tell you something, folks, that's a big pile of stuff if you got 250 of each one of those like I do. You either can take and throw it out in the back field somewhere, or you take it and you build a compost, okay? I take the main base that I use chicken manure, because that's all I can get in our area. I use a chicken manure, and it's too hot to put directly on the soil, and it's very harmful to put it too hot on the ground for a lot of different reasons. I'll put a layer of chicken manure, then I'll put a layer of whether it's broccoli, cauliflower, whatever. I'll put a layer of chicken manure, and I'll put a layer of hay. I'll put a layer of chicken manure, and I'll keep doing that. You know how that's done? Yes, ma'am. Say it out loud. Yes, ma'am. And a pair of muck boots. And I'm near knee-deep in poo. Yeah. It's a dirty job. And it does stink. And when it's warm, that heat's coming up out of that compost pit. And it just about likes to choke you at times. But I'm going to tell you something. After 3 months, after that being stacked together, it starts breaking down. And after about 3 months, I get out there with my pitchfork, and that 50-foot row I start down here at, and I put another layer of whatever down here, and off it goes. I put another layer on top of that, and there it goes. And I build another compost pit, or just, you know, I just back and forth like this with that 50-foot row. And by the time the season's ready for me to do fall gardening, which is coming up not far away, I then can take that compost pit and it's turned into this dark, super rich material that when I put it in my 30-inch beds, which we're going to discuss in our next section, when I put it into that 30-inch bed at about an inch and a half to 2 inches thick and work it into the ground, you know what happens? Yeah, that's right. The plants come alive. And they get that. You build a compost pile of that size, the more the merrier. The more you put in your soil, the mellower it becomes and the livelier it becomes and the healthier it becomes for the plants and the living organisms that are in that soil. Now, that's only part of it. And I'm over time, 3 minutes. Let's quit, and we'll take it up at the next meeting, okay? All right, so let's close with prayer. Father in heaven and dear loving Jesus, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for the simple practical things that we can discuss. Some of the arts and some of the things that we have lost over the time of history, we just want to reclaim a little bit. Help us to experience a little bit of the Garden of Eden before things really get rough. Help us, dear Jesus, please, to trust in you. We thank you for your creative power that still gives the earth its ability to do what it does. Keep us now, I pray and thank you, this afternoon. Amen.